Hello, welcome all, and thank you for joining my session about transactions in a microservice world. A little word about the agenda, but it will be short as you see. First, a few words about a transaction. You all know what a transaction is, but what are the challenges in a microservice environment? A few words about MicroProfile and the long-running actions and what the specifications tries to solve, namely the transactions in a microservice environment. And then, because we all like to see some code in action, I have prepared a few demos so that you can see the MicroProfile long-running action doing its job, so that you can see the commits and rollbacks in action and all the various aspects which are defined in that specification. So my name is Rudy De Busser. I'm working for the Payara service team, but I'm also involved in the MicroProfile groups. I'm a committer there, and also in the Eclipse Foundation, the Jakarta EE groups, mainly around security. You can see my Twitter handle there if you like to follow me or want to give me some feedback, and you also the blogs that I'm writing. So a transaction, as a developer, we all know what a transaction is, and it is a typical concept for the monolith, of course, because there we have all the information closely together. We can control very well when we start and end the transaction, which we like to keep short because we try to avoid locks, of course, if that is anything that we can do. But of course, in a microservice world, there you have multiple databases. Each microservice should have its own database. So what are you trying to do then there in that situation? Are you trying to write to multiple databases only at the end? And things like that. There is, of course, something available which is called XA transactions, which is designed for something like a single, to having something like a single transaction over multiple databases or even other resources like a GMS queue. But it has a protocol which is called the two-phase commits. I'm not going into detail, but the problem there is that it's not scalable in a microservice environment because you have that possibility that you need to do a recovery, because you have to prepare for failure in a distributed system like a microservice. So when there is a database not accessible or there is something going on, then of course then you have an issue because there are still locks held at the other databases, and then you come into trouble. So XA transactions, everyone agrees on, if you read all the resources on the internet, XA transactions, you should not use them within a microservice. But of course, transactions, they come with a lot of good things, and developers are using it a lot, and they have every right to do so, because transactions do a lot of things for the developer that they do not need to take care of themselves. The ACID principle, the atomicity, consistency, and isolation, and also durability, it is stored reliable. But with those ACID principle, the developer does need to take care that if he writes to two tables within a database or whatever, that maybe the data which he has stored already in one table cannot be read by another user which is querying that same table. Only after the commit is done, you see all the values. There is isolation and there is consistency in the data which are readable by everyone. So that's a very good thing, but there is one catch. Namely, there is the CAP theorem. You have that consistency, availability, and partitioning, and they have even proven it mathematically, so there is no need to bypass it in some way, that from those three principles, you can only have two at the same time. So if you have partitioning, like in a microservice environment, you have to give up the consistency or the availability. There is no way around it. most companies, most people, they give up consistency, and then you have something which is called eventual consistency. At a certain point in the future, all data is again nicely aligned. Interesting, a few weeks ago I had a discussion with someone and they said, oh, we are giving up availability because consistency is so important for us. So, but you have to choose one of the two. Another issue with transactions is what's called long-running transactions. You can have multiple data sources in that case, but that's not the most important stuff, is that? But the thing is, you have a business process like the one that's on the screen there, sorry. The one that's on the screen where you have different steps. And each step can be done by a different person, like a workflow. So between the beginning and the end, it can be that there are several minutes, several hours before the flow is finished. Where do you going to save your data to the database? Only at the end, in the beginning, but then again you have the option and the issue that data is already read before it is maybe cancelled in the step 5. So what is your single unit of work in such a long-running transaction? Another typical example is that a website where you can book your flight and your hotel and your car rental and your museum visits and whatever. But at the end of that process, you hope that when you have paid your all your resources that you have reserved, that your flight seat is still available and not taken by someone else. So all these examples are situations where transactions are not suited, as we know them from the monolith situation. So in the microservice world, you do not have atomicity, you only have eventual consistency, and you do not have isolation. Which of course is also important for that eventual consistency and isolation. For instance, if you or using that data for other reasons, like you do some data warehousing or you do the data reporting, because if you have already saved a few of your data, which can maybe revert it later on, then what is your actual state of your data? So that is, of course, an issue, but not one that we are going to solve in this session. The thing that we are going to try to solve in this session is, how can we make sure that if you have a process, like I showed you there, in a business process with several steps, that you, at the end, the outcome is guaranteed to have something consistent. Either you confirm that every step is done correctly and that the commit that you have done is verified. For instance, your flight seat that you have already reserved is final because you have paid. Or in the case that, for instance, that your the user just dropped out, he just closed his browser after a few times and he never paid, that seat reservation is again made available. So you have one thing, certainty, that is, it is eventual consistent at the end, and that's mostly done by the SAGA pattern, where you define each step, each business step, where you define for each business step two actions. The actual action of inserting or updating data for it, reserve your flight seat. But you also have a second action, which is called in the case when there is something wrong further on in the process. You did not pay for whatever reason. You just stopped with your reservation because you changed your mind and you were thinking, oh, I'm not going to Barcelona this weekend for obvious reasons, but soon to another city. So that second action will be called when you need to undo your first one. And that SAGA pattern, there are a few available implementations. But we created also one with the microprofile group. Who knows already about the microprofile specifications? Who has already heard it? So the idea of microservices, as those few people that already worked with it, is that you have better tools to create a microservice with something like the enterprise Java technology. Technically, you can do it already. That's not a problem. But of course, there are a few tools missing which are optimal in such a distributed environment. So they took some basic Java EE, now Jakarta EE specifications like CDI, YaxRS for the REST endpoints, and the JSON handling, the JSON processing and JSON binding. And on top of that, they defined something very useful things for those environments like configuration. We heard it already a few times. You need to configure your microservices depending on the environment. You need something very important like fault tolerance. You are in distributed systems, so retry, failback, and things like that. You have to take that in consideration. Security, the JOT propagation. Metrics and health checks, to see if your service is still running correctly and things like that. So there is a whole bunch of specifications which you can have with different runtimes. It's not only one vendor who is providing you all these specifications, but you can choose between one of those other vendors also. We have a first release candidate available for that microprofile long-running actions, which is based on that Saga pattern. The API is more or less stable, is there placed, but in the last 2 or 3 months, there was not one single change in API. We're just fine-tuning the specifications, writing more TCK tests, etc. So it's a good time to have a look at it if you're interested in that long-running action specifications, which is usable within that microservice environment, and it is very loosely coupled. You only have one header, mainly, which is propagated through all your microservices, and based on that header, he knows that it's part of the same transaction, and at some point, you can do a commit or rollback. I'm still using those terms, but of course, it does not make sense in these situations. Bit of a conceptual image. It's not always like that the coordinator is a completely separate process, like with the Payara implementation, where it is integrated within your service itself. But every time you call a YaxRS resource, a YaxRS endpoint, there is some participant watching over that. And based on the header information and the information that you define on the YaxRS endpoint, he can decide that he's interested in that endpoint, in that call, in that series of calls, and he lists himself with the coordinator. At the end, if the last one says, okay, this flow is done, the transaction is closed, is finished, then all the other participants can be contacted again by the coordinator to say, okay, you need to do the final processing, the closing. For instance, mark your seat, your flight seat as paid, for instance, or you can do the undo action, the compensating action. As I said, a lot of demos, because that's more interesting. First, a few concepts. Everything is defined declarative. So on a YaxRS endpoint, on a YaxRS resource, you can define the @LRA annotation, which defines the transaction. Does it need to start a new transaction? Needs it to enlist itself with an existing one? So, or even if there is an existing one, start as a child transaction. And then you can annotate another method with @compensate or @complete, and then those methods will be called in the case there needs to be done the compensating action or the complete action. And as I mentioned, there is only one thing which is propagated through all the flows of microservices that you have, and that's that header, where you have an LRA ID, this, which is a URI and uniquely defines your transaction so that all the management around your transaction can be performed. So let's start with the hello world. It's not very realistic, but next to this one, I'll show you more realistic example, but to give you an idea how it works. So this is an application which is just using basic micro profile. It's already an old version because it's 2.0. We have released 3.1 last week, but I'm just using YAX resin points from the micro profile, but of course can be combined with all the rest. The example, of course, uses also the micro profile of Payara. Since it's not yet available within the server, I need to specify it here as a dependency. But that, of course, will be that requirement will be lifted afterwards when it is officially released. You have a standard YaxRS resource that you annotate with @path, and you have that @get method, which will be called if you do a call to that hello endpoint. And I define here that this resource is under transaction, not very useful because when this before this method is called, just before this method is called with the help of an interceptor, the transaction is started and it will be ended by the time that the return method, the return statement is performed. I come back later on this to have a transaction which spans multiple resources, which is obviously the most useful one. And you can request that unique ID because it's just an header parameter, so you can use the standard YaxRS ways of retrieving that one. So let's start it up. And then you will see that in the case, because this is a regular hello world, so there is nothing wrong with it, it's complete successfully, which means that this complete method will be called after this method, after this endpoint is called. In the case that we have an error, we call this compensate. In the case here, when we call this cancel endpoint, where we have a web application exception, but more on that later, how you can do the compensating action more in detail. So let's have the endpoint intro LRA REST hello. My endpoint returns that unique ID. You see that it's a URI. There is already the name of the implementation in, because in a future version of that specification, we will allow to have an interaction between the coordinators of the different implementations. Now it is only limited to one. And then just a unique ID, which gives its a unique identification. And in the log, you see that complete method which is called just for that endpoint. Same goes if you go with cancel, then you have that internal server error. The compensate is called in this case. And if you look at the overall system, there you can see that you have one LRA, which is still known by the system. The state of it, the global outcome was cancelled, and the different participants, so that are the different microservices which took part in that transaction, you can see also the status, and you see that the compensate is called. After some while, maybe I've talked long enough, yes, that information is gone because we do not keep information for forever. The transaction is handled completely, successfully, done, so we are removing that information. A more realistic one, because this is, of course, a hello world, never realistic. So we close the transaction immediately if you do not specify that it needs to be kept open. That is to protect the developer who forgets to keep it open, because otherwise, if you start a transaction and you forget to close it somewhere, then the transaction could live in theory forever and keeps it's kept open forever. So that's why by default we close it immediately. But there is a more realistic example here, which also shows the interaction between three different JVMs, so that you see that it really is a distributed system. And I show first maybe the ID of the demo, then it's easier to follow. Yeah, there is also different ways of defining your transactions. Those who know that those EGB transactions, well, we have taken most of them from that specification, so you can require a new one or use an existing one, etc., etc. So the example is using three different microservices, and the first is the service A, which receives your call from the front end, and then calls first the service B, which starts your transaction, and the information is then that LRA ID is used by that service A after that first call to B to propagate also to that service C, which ends your transaction. So even we have 2 or 3 or 10 or 100 different services who takes part of your transaction, it doesn't matter. All the information is propagated through all the parties that's being needed, and in the case that the service C ends your transaction, but service B is informed about the outcome. Is it successfully closed, or does a compensating action is required? I'll start the complete environment already, because that takes a while, because I have three services which need to be started. We have here service A, our main resource, which call that service B endpoint. And from the result, from that call, we take that header with that LRA ID. And we use that also in the header for that service C call. And we just return it as a global value so that you can eventually match all the information. In the service B, we again start the transaction, but we in here define that it should not be closed immediately, but kept open, of course. Again, we have that compensate and complete method, so in case the transaction ends, we get notified, and we can do the actual steps that are required. Here we just print out, we do not even take the LRA ID, which should be more realistic. And in that service C, we say, okay, we ended here because we did not define end here. But we say that it is mandatory, saying if we call this service C without the header, without a valid header, then we will return a status 412 automatically by the implementation, meaning you try to call a service which expects that there is a transaction going so that it can join that existing one. If that's not the case, well, then there is something wrong, and we just return status 412 without calling the actual method. In this case, we return successfully, or when I should comment this out, then we can have the failure case. But now, because we have a success, we will have the complete methods which are called. So important here, this is a more realistic, more real-world thing. We have three different JVMs running for the moment. That could be in three different parts of the world, as long as they can see each other, so that they can exchange information, that's okay. So then we have here the endpoint of this one, that's the service A endpoint main. Again, service B is called, service C is called, we get that LRA ID back as information. We have that system out information. So even that service C completed the transaction, service B is informed. And when I'm quick enough, I'm not quick enough. So let's do it again. It's not because it's not intro anymore, it's distributed. Distributed now, it's service A, it's called. There you can see that there is a closed transaction and that service B and service C were involved in this transaction. A few more words on how you can do that compensating, because that's obviously the most important one. Let's stop this first, otherwise I have an issue. So you can compensate in a few ways. And important for that compensating is that, as I told you already, the coordinator is calling this method, which is annotated with compensate. But he also needs confirmation of that you as a service received that request for compensation and that you are either handling it and you will reply with the outcome in the future, or that you immediately say, okay, I've done all the necessary steps, and you just return that to the coordinator. Because the coordinator, as I said, we need to know that all these steps are done in the area for that transaction. So we need to know that the effect that the compensating action is effectively done and finished before we say, okay, this transaction, we can forget about it. In the previous examples, I just returned void as an answer that will tell the coordinator that the compensating is done and he can forget about it. But we can also return a certain status of our action, saying we are in the process of compensating, because a compensating action can again take some time. It can again needs to contact other parties. This compensating action can again start a new transaction, because it is again maybe a distributed action. Or it can return, as I said, the final outcome, everything is done and it is compensated. In this example, the compensate action returns the first time's compensating, so that is still in the process of doing. That is a trigger for the coordinator to recall this method afterwards again. You, with Payara, you can configure that time. I've set it now as very low, because otherwise we have to wait a lot of time. So after 4 seconds, the coordinator will call this compensate method again, asking for that participant, okay, you were asked to compensate you that action, is that already done, or is you're still in the process of doing it? I use a counter, so after 5 times, he says, okay, I've done with it, it is okay. But if it's not completely finished, then the coordinator will all the time recall that same method over and over again. So we have here the compensating example, compensating, where we repeatedly call a certain endpoint. We throw a web application exception so that we call that compensating action. And if we see it in the log, then you see that it is going on every 4 seconds. The coordinator tries to get the status out of it. And after the 5th time, when he received that complete, that the action is completed, then there is no call anymore. This is just to make sure that that we have that eventual consistency, that we know that everything is correctly again, because that's the only guarantee that we can give you. That's basically anything that you can do in a distributed environment. But of course, calling the same method over and over again is not very object-oriented way, maybe because That method is called to initiate the compensate action, and afterwards it is called to get the status of that compensating action. So there are two functionalities handled by the same method. That's not the ideal situation. So therefore, besides that at compensate annotation, we also defined the at status annotation. And the first time, you can already imagine what happens, the first time the coordinator will call this one. In the case that the participant returns a status of compensating, then the second time, and in this case again, five times in total, this status method will be called with the same URI asking for what is your status, are you done? The same functionality as before, but now split it up in two different methods, which is maybe a bit better. But of course you can do something else, because okay, why returning immediately saying, oh, I have I'm working on it, and that the coordinator needs to ask then again, oh, have you done it? Still doing it? Maybe the asynchronous approach is a better way. Instead of returning a participant status as such, we can also return a completion stage, a completable future. So the method will return immediately. The coordinator will see, okay, this is an asynchronous method, and at a certain point in the future, I will check every now and then to see if that completable future has a certain value. And then the advantage is, of course, that you only have to write it once. Here, there is a new thread started, which just waits 20 seconds. Yes, it's hello world still type things. But at a certain point, the thing is finished, and you can set the completable future to the value compensated, and that will be picked up by the coordinator, and then it will be propagated, and the things will be closed. So let's see that also in action. So we have here the asynchronous. Again, we have that error. We have that message here that it starts the compensate in the log. Let's have again here the LRA one saying that it is, what was it, compensating. You see, the status is cancelling. It's in progress. The participant saying, oh, he's in process of compensating. At a certain moment, we come to that end here. We set that compensate value, and the system picks it up and say, oh, it is canceled, and it is because that one service has compensated the actions that he needs to do. So that's another way. That are the three most important ways of defining how you should write your compensating actions. Now a few random features. I do not have the time to go over all of them or run all of them. One of the features is that you can define a timeout on a transaction. You can say, okay, I start my transaction, but it can be only open for 5 seconds, 5 hours, 5 years, whatever. But you can define an end time. If that end time is elapsed, if that time period is elapsed, then it is automatically closed and your compensate action will be called. That's to avoid when you're on that online situation where someone just closes his browser and never comes back, then you can say, oh, after 24 hours, sorry, but we kick them out and we do the compensate action. There are other things that we can do. Let's see what I can show you. Yeah, there is, although I'm not going to run it, in sometimes you have this situations, for instance, that online thing that you have reserved first your car, and then you say, oh no, I've changed my mind. So when the user initiates your action of starting a compensation, then you can also define that with an annotation. So this is the regular one which we have already discussed and saw already in action a few times. So the service joins the transaction, but then that same service is called by through another endpoint saying, oh no, skip that car reservation. So you do the compensating action yourself here, and then with that at leave annotation, you mark that action to your coordinator saying, okay, this microservice is no longer part of your transaction. And so when your transaction closes, the complete and compensate are no longer called because you have stepped out of the transaction. What was this example about? This is here again an example of that mandatory end in the case where you would like to have a compensating action, but you also can have an after array that you and you do not need that compensate. I think the other one was like that. Yes, here the other one. After the LRA is ended, you can get also information back. That can be for statistics, that can be for loggings, that can for be metrics. So you're not actually taking part of the compensation, but you like to get notified about the outcome of the action, and that can be done by the after LRA. One thing that was maybe not clear for the moment, but the only thing that the coordinators keep for you is that unique ID. You have to keep the link between that transaction ID and the action that the user does yourself. So if you say, I start a certain flow that has probably also a unique ID, you need to match those two yourself. Because at the end, if I go back to that one of those examples here, the only thing that you get back from that coordinator is, this was the transaction what I was talking about. So it does not have any business value. A thing which is will be possible in a future version, but not for the moment, but we have already implemented it, is that the coordinator does not only keep that transaction ID for you, but also keeps some business data for you. And later on, there is now just in an experimental phase, that you can store information in that global thing that's running there for you. And at the moment that you do your complete action, that you can just retrieve that information. So that you do not need to keep that link between that transaction ID and your business ID that you have done, that you have created yourself. So these are the main features of this specification. I have repeated most of them on the slides. The slides will be, the link to the slides will be posted online, so you can look there. If you want to go over it later on again. A few takeaways to close this session. So I talked about that the classic approach for transaction is not applicable for something like a microservice due to various reasons. That you can have something which uses that compensatable actions at that saga pattern by using the microprofile long-running actions, which is just a loosely coupled specification on top of Yext REST resources. You only need that header, which is managed for you, and the rest is built around it. We are in progress, but as I said, the API is already stable for 3 months, so maybe it's a good thing to have a look at it as you want to know more about it. The link to the GitHub project of the microprofile LRA specification and a link to the demo code that I used here today. I have a few minutes, but maybe it's easier if you have questions that you come over and that you can ask me those questions. So thank you for your attention, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the sessions today and tomorrow. Thank you.